All right, this time I'd like to call the meeting to order. This is a special meeting of the Ramapo Central School District Board of Education, Tuesday, March 29, 2016. The time is now. 7:04. Take 7:04. Thank you, Angela. Let the record reflect that all board members are present, with the exception of Marlies, who has been expecting not to be there, so I'm sure she'll be here shortly. If we could all please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance, because the flag is to my left. Pledge of Allegiance.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Hello, can you hear me? Okay, so Dr. Howard sent an email explaining she had a conflict that could not be avoided, a presentation that she's presented to a medical society tonight, and will be catching up at 7:30 as fast as she can. An email, thank you.
She sent the email to?
To all of us.
Okay, thank you. Sometimes it's slow. Okay, Dr. Howard, with respect to, there's one item on the agenda for tonight, and that, of course, is the presentation of the Suffolk Middle School turf fields. That's 1.04. What I'd just like to say is to introduce Chris Colby. Chris Colby is an architect from the, from Clark Patterson Lake, otherwise known as CPL. Clark Patterson Lake. Chris, if you would step up, please. Chris is from, an architect from the firm Clark Patterson Lake. Chris, I just want to thank you. I know you're going to introduce the panel members. Just want to thank you on behalf of the board and the district for assisting and coordinating this presentation and aligning the speakers. I want to appreciate it. At this time, I will turn the mic over to you. Board members, if you want to, I reserve the front row. If you want to sit in the front row, you will not be able to see up here, so. And just for the public, just so you're aware, for those who have attended board meetings before, what the process will be basically is that there'll be a presentation by a party soon to be introduced. At the end of the presentation, you know, board members may have some questions to the parties. With respect to the public participation portion of the meeting, which is usually asking questions and there's no answers, at this point, we will allow the public to come up and approach the either microphone and ask questions of any of the panelists. And I'll review the procedures at that time. Thank you.
Thank you. So, once again, I'm an architect with Clark Patterson Lake, otherwise known as CPL. I'm a principal with the firm. I've been an architect working in this district. My history with the district dates back to approximately 2003. So with me tonight, I also have from our firm, Clark Patterson Lake, Tim Moog, who is our civil site leader for the firm. He's also principal and has done a lot of work here in the district. Lee DeFreitas with us tonight is a representative from Shaw Sports, who is basically an installation kind of guru who's seen the history of sports turf fields from, you know, AstroTurf type of installations to what are now to be more organic and other types of synthetic infills. So he's here to speak to that tonight. And also with us, we have Dr. Laura Green, who is a toxicologist, to speak to some of the concerns that many of you have voiced relative to chrome rubber. So I'm just going to give a brief kind of brief summary of what we're going to talk about tonight. The others that I've introduced are much smarter than me on these topics, so I'll let them speak to with their expertise. So As you all know, we're here tonight. There's some concern in the district relative to the turf field, specifically at this location. Mainly the chrome rubber and the possible reuse for reinstallation of that infill and a turf field. I'd like to discuss at first, Tim will address the existing conditions and the construction that you currently have on site and what options exist moving forward. Some of those will relate to the State Education Department, who is the governing authority when we design these projects. They review these installations and how they're designed and how they're installed and what the impacts are, both from a cost point of view, longevity, warranty, things like that. At this time, SED, State Education Department, has no comment on what turf field infill districts use in the state of New York. We'd like to address life cycle, play time, because that is a factor in the type of field you use, whether that be a natural grass field or a synthetic turf field, and also the type of infill. The district's athletic director, Andy Guccione, is here tonight, so he could address the playtime and what is currently seen in the district. Again, types of infill, so there's many, many different types from the chrome rubber that you're familiar with to more organic types of infills that can be used, and different types of layering systems that are also used with these systems. Those types of infills and systems all have different cost considerations, so we'd like to review that with these nine as well. Making a decision to go from one type of infill to another will have potential cost impacts for the district over time. And then finally, before we get into questions and answers, I'd like to have Dr. Green talk about some of the toxicology concerns specific to chrome rubber, as it is the current field that you've had and potentially not absolutely, but potentially could be installing in the future. The whole point of our panel discussion tonight is to take what we know and inform you of the facts that we have at hand with the design considerations that the district is considering and that we use as professionals, design professionals, installation professionals, so that you can make a more informed decision. This is really a community decision. This is not a decision that we're here to steer anybody on the board in the community in one direction or another, but we're here to help and answer questions. So with that, I will turn it over to Tim to discuss what you currently have on site here.
Good evening, everybody. As Chris mentioned, site designer with Clark Patterson Lee. My background is in geology. I focus a lot with soil and water and apply that to civil site designs. I was involved in helping to kind of rehab some of the natural turf fields that you have flanking the practice field. But as Chris said, we're trying to flag decisions that need to come along this process so that at the end, everybody is in tune with what's required. And along the decision process, the first thing is a natural field versus a synthetic field. The advantages of the synthetic field are obviously it can withstand weather, extreme weather conditions, extreme flake conditions. And as Chris mentioned, Andy has records that show there's over 2,000 hours of play time documented on your main stadium field there, that upper field. Those kind of hours and that intense use cannot be supported by a natural field with such a limited landscape as you can see that's basically the black outline of the school property. So the first decision is synthetic versus natural turf, and I think based on your use records, it lends itself to a synthetic application. We're calling this the stadium field. It's roughly 78,400 square feet. It's got a comprehensive drainage system underneath, which I can show you a slide next. The next field is the practice field, which is generally used for soccer, and it's kind of hard to see in these aerials, and the aerials are dated probably 2009, but you can still see sort of intense wear patterns that accumulate on these, especially where goalies stand. Clark Patterson was hired by the district back about a year ago to do basically an analysis of the integrity of the existing synthetic fields. The stadium and both the stadium and practice field consists of a crumb rubber with a sand infill. We looked at both the fiber, the tough bind, and also the GMAX, which is the impact force of the material. It's a scientific test. At the time we did the test, the max G level was 200. The test that the district provided, it was ranging from 163.85 for the stadium field and 152.9 for the practice field. Both were under the 200 max threshold, indicating that the cushion ability and the safety factor of the field was still pretty good, although they were showing signs of wear. And in our opinion, the field fibers have seen their expected life. So a point of fact that just came up recently is that this GMAX value of 200 is looking to be changed by both the turf industry as well as ASTM standards, which could lower this value. That lowering of the value could happen, I think, in June of this summer, and it's rumored that it would be 150. So if that value does get lower to 150, we strongly recommend that the district retest the fields to see that it still meets within that safety threshold. Another thing is, what do you have for existing conditions? As part of the synthetic turf field, it's basically like wall-to-wall carpet. I don't know if anybody's ever seen that installed in your house, but they tack like a little wooden strip with nails around the perimeter. They stick the carpet in and pull it across. It's somewhat similar in that they don't have nails sticking up, but they have a concrete anchoring curve which goes all the way around the track, and the carpet itself is adhered to that. The entire system, if you will, is like a lasagna. You have an upper cheese layer, which is the synthetic turf. Below that are multiple layers of stone, which promote this cushion ability, but also mainly drainage, because that's one of the big benefits of a synthetic field, is it can pour rain and you're playing on it within a half an hour later. Another advantage that you wouldn't have over a synthetic or over a natural field. So again, we're talking about the decisions that have to be made. The district has its infrastructure already in place, and it's related to the existing synthetic field. So that's a good foundation to work on. And it would make sense to, you know, basically pull up the carpet, put a new carpet down, and then the next decision is the infill. In that process, and we will get into it shortly, there's several variations in the infill. The infill is a combination of sand and other additives, whether it's chrome rubber or cork or coconut fibers. There's various mixtures that go together, and the infill actually makes the grass pile stand up to look like real grass. And it also offers drainage and cushionability. So we already have the foundation, if you will. The next decision would need to be made in this design application is, should we add a cushion underneath the grass pile that you see there? The existing system is designed in the Stats factory without this cushion. The cushion would be required if you were going to switch the infill system and go to one of these alternative methods. There's an added cost for the cushion. It doesn't really limit you in the future, but the thing is that it would have to be installed while the existing carpet is ripped off. So again, in the decision process, the district would have to decide, yes, go ahead with this cushion, and then the next thing would be the pile and the infill mix. And all that has a cost related to it, and I think it's important in the decision, so we'll let Lee kind of run through the various different piles, and pile being the grass plant of the carpet and the infill system and the pad and associated costs.
Could have found a little better picture up there. Brad Pitt would have worked for that. Anyway, as Tim said, thanks for the introduction. I'm Lee DeFreitas, and I am with Shaw, but I'm really not necessarily here to represent Shaw tonight. I've been around 30 years in the industry, as Chris said. So I just by even default, I've seen a lot of things, you know, come and go, and I think I can speak at least, I thought I'd take a generic approach to what's out there and the pros and cons. But I will say one thing about Shaw is that we are a very R&D-driven company. And I don't have all the answers, but I can certainly find them within our company because we have built a tremendous lab. We're very risk-averse. If you go on our web, we're part of Shaw Industries, the carpet company, and part of Berkshire Hathaway. So we're very protective of our space and protective of you folks out there very sustainable driven company as well. So I think we do have a good basis for this. I did want to comment about the GMAX part because I think it is part of the decision that you have and maybe the most important because you're reaching levels. Just to put that in perspective, GMAX is a test that was developed in the 60s and 70s, not to get into too much detail. It started with the auto industry and head-sitting dashboards. So it was adapted for synthetic turf. So it's a very important test. It was football driven, but not necessarily only for football because we have other sports. I was a soccer player, no helmet, no protection. And you guys out there that play soccer know you get upended. For whatever sport, we got to protect the kids. So just to kind of give you a parameter of what that means, and your fields are really, in my mind, at the upper level of where you'd want to be. It's sort of a scale. So 200 Gs is what they found in these impact tests, and you basically have a little tube that drops a weighted. It's meant to duplicate the weight of a head and a helmet, and you drop it so many 2 feet down, and gives you this measure of shock absorbency, what the turf is giving back to the athlete. So 200 Gs was for a while the standard. They said at that point, it's not an absolute, but at that point the incidence of head injury would increase to the point where they set that as the standard, let's put it that way. On the other side, you have the money field. It could be 40, 50 Gs. The best natural grass fields, we always say Tampa Bay, Notre Dame, we used to talk about, they have turf now. They typically are 90 to 100 Gs. Sometimes if you have these sand dress grass fields that you've seen, you get to about 130 Gs, like a golf green, something like that. And that sort of is the range. And in the turf industry, we all talk about staying, very natural, but a lot of these fields will start to get out of that range. And the thing about GMAX is if you're at 100 Gs, 200 Gs isn't necessarily double the risk. There's a head injury criterion that comes in this. It's 5 times the risk. So as you start to ramp up, I'm not trying to scare anybody, but really, if you want to maintain that grass-like level, the way the fields were built, there's a way to do it within this. And that's why the ASTM and the Synthetic Turf Council has already lowered their standard down to the 160, 150 range because we want to. And I always use the example of a furnace in the building. If it's going to explode at 200 Gs, we're not all sitting in the room. We're out of the building. So the same thing with turf fields. You want it to maintain a lower level as long as you can, and that's all in the way they construct it. So I don't want to belabor that, but I think it's important. So I just thought I'd talk real quickly about these systems in general, how they're made up. Some of you may have been involved in the last project. The typical infill turf system, we started out with the carpet style systems. They all had pads underneath. Contrary to belief, they were pretty shock absorbent. They didn't feel as good. But then we got into these newer style infill fields, and the fibers are really grass-like. They're made of polyethylene. It's a waxy fiber. So great for feel and comfort, very grass-like. And then we fill them up with infill, and I've got all various kinds up here. This one little tube has every kind that we would use. But the typical infill has been black rubber mixed with sand or 100% rubber, recycled infill, recycled tires rather. That's been the standard. We're going to talk a lot about alternatives and some people's perception that alternatives are a brand new thing based on recent reports. That's not true. There's alternative infills have been around a long time for different reasons. Organic infills have been around for 10, 15 years in some parts of the world and certain kinds here in the U.S. So, but that's the typical system. It's hard to see in the box, but I'll be glad to pass these around. This was similar to what your field looked like when it came in. It was typically a 2 to 2.5 inch fiber filled with rubber sand. And that's the key characteristic. You need at least 2 inches that your current fields do not have a pad because the pad is the infill. It makes up the system. And there's in a 2.5 inch system, for example, which you probably started with, probably inch and a half of infill in there as it started. And that's, so we kind of put the pad in the turf. And that's been the sort of the traditional system and the way most of them go down. And there's now all kinds of variations of that. But that's how they start. I mean, the turf sort looks like this at the beginning, and then you put it on the field and you mix the infill, and as you brush it, it becomes more and more grass-like looking as it wears. So that's sort of the norm, the higher percentage of fields go in like that. Tim mentioned pads. You know, pads, again, are not reserved for just alternative infills or organic infills, and I'm going to, again, talk about these infills. I'm sure you've all seen the discussion about concussions. I mean, it's an added cost, but you can even put pads, many people will put pads under the traditional infill systems as a belt and suspenders approach. You have the infill there, but if the infill firms up and hardens over time, you have a pad. So a pad is not necessarily tied to an organic or a certain kind of infill. It can actually be in itself a tool for just really locking in shock absorbency. So if the infill all blew away one day, you know, it's not going to happen, but your kids would be protected. The other thing that it does, it allows you to be flexible with the infill. And we're seeing, again, as we get into varying infills and varying systems to address perceptions in the market of infill, for one, is that when you put a pad down, now you can shorten the turf, you can go denser, you can go with products that have very limited infill in them comparatively. On a normal, just to give you a comparison, on a normal turf field, you know, your field's probably went in with 9 pounds weight of infill. In a typical system that we might do, 2.25 inches, I don't want to get too many facts out here, but we would use like 3.5 pounds of rubber and 1.5 pounds of sand. So you've got 5 or 6 pounds of stuff in there. And that's somewhat dynamic. If you go shorter and denser, you're really potentially reducing the amount of infill in the system. And really, in my mind, the interaction or the with the actual skin onto the infill, you create systems that there's very little infill movement or interaction with the skin. So a pad has a lot of functions other than just tied to an organic. But I kind of divide the systems up in two categories. There's rubber-like, so the traditional system or the most used system has been SBR rubber and sand or SBR by itself, and Dr. Green's going to talk very specific about SBR rubber and fills and the chemical makeup of the infills. So that's still the dominant amount of fields go in with that infill. Other rubber-like materials, and what I mean by rubber-like is they're sized the same, they perform the same. You know, we have a very specific sizing we like that's tied to athletic performance. You know, we just don't order up to the tire guy and say, you know, crush up some tires and we put it in the field. We've determined a very specific ratio for different sports and to, again, protect your kids. And it's not only shock absorbency, it's foot release, how it goes into the turf and how it sets in the turf or how the ball bounces. So there's about 6 to 8 specific tests that we do to judge performance of the turf. Very different than even 10 years ago. We're getting very sport specific, but we're getting real specific as to how these fields perform on a scientific level. So on the rubber-like category, some of them you find are EPDM rubber, where is SBR, big long name, which you can pronounce for me later, but it's basically recycled tires. And then EPDM rubber is a virgin material that's made, you used to see it in roofing membranes and the tops of running tracks. And the theory is that it has less of the harmful chemicals that perceived harmful chemicals in SBR rubber. So we just did NIAC High School down the road here, and they went with an EPDM rubber. And again, a lot of this, all these infills depend, the overriding factor is getting good raw materials and good sourcing as well, because you can have, good or bad of any of this stuff. One that's not up there is coated rubber, where we take SBR and it's coated with an acrylic coating, a painted and then an acrylic. And the theory is you're kind of sealing it up again to, lock in this perceived bad stuff that's in there. And we'll do a handful of those a year of the coated rubber. And a great improvement. Some of the, there's been, again, pros and cons, some of the early issues to that were that the coating didn't stay on, but I think we've got better sources of that now. So that's an option that's out there. And I'm kind of going up the ladder, you know, in price, and we can get to that, but you know, SBR is the most prevalent. It's also the least expensive, and it's the best overall performer. Then you go to coated rubber, and then EPDM rubber. Some of the other ones that we see are TPE. It's a thermoplastic elastomer. It's not made or vulcanized, so to speak, such as EPDM or SBR. So again, it doesn't have some of the in perception the chemicals that the rubbers have, but really high priced. And we've had issues with some of it reverting back to a gummy substance. So that's what TPE is. Again, it all depends on the source. Nike grunge, when you heard about Nike grunge, is recycled sneakers. Again, perception, because we wear it on our shoes, it's safer than regular rubber. We have not used it wholesale for a few reasons. One is the sizing of it hasn't been the same as what we would use in an athletic performing field. The other problem is that the sources are mostly in Asia, so it's very difficult to get good information and document on how it's made. You know, what the quality control is in these plants, and typically it comes from a lot of sources that comes together to make your field, and whereas most of the other ones are made in one source. So at least we know we can track the quality control and the history of it. It's very difficult with Nike grind. So that actually covers most of the rubber-like. And the rubber-like ones, again, don't necessarily need a pad. They perform just like, for the most part, SBR rubber, very similar. Then you get into the organic categories, and you really have just a few. You have ground up coconut, ours is specifically called Geofill. We have an agreement. There's two main suppliers in the world. It comes from, they're both Italian companies. We have an exclusive with Geofill. Dates back to 2005. There's 1,000 installations of coconut filled fields out there that we just did at Pleasantville High School not far. We have two installs there. So by rights, it's one of the most, if not the most used alternative infill out there, but just really getting a foothold in the United States. Then you have sand. The prevalent one out there is instead of just regular silica sand that we use in the field, this product is actually, the brand name is called Envirofill. It's an acrylic coated sand. And it's actually, the coating has antimicrobials in it. So they position it to have benefits that way. It's a round sand. It's almost like a little BB. The advantage is, again, organic. Because of its shape, it resists compaction with this sand, so it's very firm. And then you have straight core, which is out there, which we have not embraced, but it is an organic. The issue with cork is it's so light that maintenance-wise, with heavy rain, it floats. But those are the three organics. The common theme with those is because they are organic and organics do compact at a higher rate than any of the rubber-type materials, and that they do have a slight decomposition over time. We will only install them with a pad, and most companies would require a pad underneath them to provide the shock absorption. So you're sort of moving the shock from inside the system here down below, mostly to the pad. So that guy's kind of gives you an overview of the systems. Again, two distinct categories. Rubber-like, rather, you know, doesn't necessarily need a pad because they perform the same, and then you have this small category of organics that would require a pad for your shock absorbers. But again, remember, this pad can be dual purpose in the way that it's protecting your kids no matter what the infill is on top. One other kind of avenue to go with these turfs is either limited infill or non-infill. There's some folks promoting no infill. I don't think it really works well for the athletics, the level of sports that are played in high school where you don't have an infill, you're almost going back to the carpet days. But you can actually, you know, get systems that are very short and dense where they require, like I said, instead of that 6-7 pounds of infill, whatever the range is. Now you're getting it down into a few pounds of infill total. And we see some folks going in that direction. And again, depending on the sport, in my mind, it would be more conducive to ball sports, soccer, and field hockey, lacrosse, as opposed to sports where you, like football, for example. So that's it's sort of when you get these products, and again, tough to see, but we can pass these around. Some of them have these little matrices down below called root zones so we have the long fiber in this root zone down here. These actually serve as fabric infill, so you're kind of taking up the space at the infill. So again, there's a lot of options in and about, not only the turf systems, but the infills. So we just ran through a budget on exactly what you did. Some pretty realistic numbers here for your specific project. This is the stadium field, and as Tim had said, 78,420 square feet. So in every replacement project, you have removal and disposal. So it is a pretty high number. We go through periods where recyclers come and they want to take the product, and sometimes they'll take the old turf at a very reduced cost, and then there's just so many fields being replaced that all of a sudden they can't take any more. And so the prices of that have kind of gone up and down. But this is a realistic quote that we got. So removing and disposing that turf, you had a system in there with 9 pounds of infill plus the turf. So by just sheer weight, there's a large amount to move out of there. And typically what they'll do is they'll cut it up and roll it up and try to repurpose it if possible and not send it to a landfill. And then you have regrading of the existing base. We typically would survey that and check undulations and bring it back to grade. That's probably the on the high end. You'd hope that maybe things would be in tolerance, that you wouldn't really need much of that money at all. Then the turf systems, I based it on a typical 2.25-inch system that would require no pad for the top one, and then you just kind of go through the levels of SBR and sand, and then you get into coated rubber, and you can see how the adds and the ramifications. You get EPDM, significantly. You start, coated is a reasonable increase, and then you start getting into the EPDMs, TPEs, and even Nike grinds, and significant increase in the infill prices for those. Then you get to the organic options, and again, most of the alternatives are triple the cost or more, and it's reflected in the geofill or the envirofill, which is the sand. I didn't price the pork out, but you've got, I did it first with just the turf price itself, and then you've got the pad options down below that you'd have to add into that. So, the prices when you get into the alternatives do ramp up, but there's some positives to that in going to that. And then just to point out on the pad side of things, most of the pads today, this one happens to be a recycled foam pad. There's rubber sheet good pads that are manufactured. All of them now come with warranties that will sustain 2 turf installations. So, you pay the big hit on the front end, but you have the life cycle value over time. We've actually, on some of these rubber sheet pads, Regipol is a brand name, if anybody's heard of that, we're on in some cases, 3rd installation of those. So, again, it's there is some longevity and life cycle value to those. And the practice field, pretty much the same, although smaller. Smaller size, so the number's just a little bit lower, but really just kind of carries across, and it's only 72,000 square feet, so you can see it just reflected, it's basically the same progression, but just lower across the board because of the smaller square footage.
Good evening, members of the board, and ladies and gentlemen of the communities. I'm really happy to be able to come here and speak with you. I want to share a little bit as a toxicologist about how toxicologists go about determining whether products are safe. It's a logical process, and at the end of it, it has to be quantitative. I think everybody here knows that everything is made up of chemicals. There's chemicals in the air, there's chemicals in our bodies. Everything is a chemical or a mixture. And when we make any decisions about safety or risk, we have to do it quantitatively. So when we think about whether chrome rubber is safe, it's really a several-step process. First, we look at the material itself and look at the ingredients. As Lee mentioned, the basis of it is a styrene butadiene rubber, or SBR. That's a synthetic rubber. It turns out, although it sounds a little scary, because styrene is actually potentially dangerous as a gas, as is butadiene, but when you put them together as a polymer, they're actually quite stable. And in fact, styrene butadiene rubber is used in chewing gum, among other things, because it's quite elastic and it's quite stable. So the styrene butadiene rubber itself is, you know, approved for chewing gum uses and lots of other things. But obviously, in tires, it's used in a commercial product. There are lots of other things in tires. There are additives. There are ultraviolet protectors, because obviously tires are out in the sunshine. There are cross-linking agents that vulcanize the tires or make the rubber stable. And for many years now, scientists have looked at whether the chemicals that are in these tires, once they are crumbled up and made into chrome rubber, whether they do or don't migrate out in dangerous quantities. And again, I want to stress the quantity issue, because if you just look at a list of chemicals in anything, whether it's any of these infills, or your diet, or your air, you can get pretty scared. You know, there are a lot of chemicals, and at high levels, some of them are quite nasty. It turns out, though, that as you might expect, because tires last a long time, the chemicals that are bound up in the vulcanized rubber do not migrate out in any substantial quantities. And this is actually the crucial test that had been done by scientists, actually in the state of New Jersey. There's some very good scientists at Rutgers at the medical school there, the Robert Wood Johnson Medical School, who a number of years ago on behalf of the New Jersey Department of Environmental Protection did a very exhaustive study. And first they very exhaustively digested tires in synthetic organic solvents to sort of see what could come out under the worst case conditions. And you can get a lot of stuff out when you put it in paint stripper, for example, or methylene chloride. But then they realized, well, that's not actually the way that people could come into contact with these materials or could be exposed to these materials. If children or other athletes are exposed, it's either if they're going to be touching and have dermal contact, or if they're going to be inhaling little particles, or if there are any vapors that come off, or if they incidentally ingest some material. So the way that scientists determine whether chemicals are going to migrate under those conditions is they use what's called a synthetic gastric fluid or synthetic lung fluid or synthetic sweat. And it turns out that when you subject chrome rubber to these synthetic biological fluids, and again, these are made to mimic how we might interact with these substances, virtually nothing comes off. In other words, they're very bound up. Incidentally, if you subject local soils to the same kind of tests, you find kind of the same thing. That is to say, you find some organic chemicals in local soils, you find some inorganic chemicals, metals, and other things. And they come up at small levels. Now, once you have a quantitative estimate of what level of what chemicals can migrate into the environment and therefore children or other athletes can be exposed, you have to run the numbers through to see whether the levels are or are not safe. And there are standard ways to do this, but everything that you do this with, you're going to get a non-zero risk. In other words, if you did a quantitative health risk assessment, and that's the process we're talking about, if you did a quantitative health risk assessment for ordinary dirt on a natural field, you get a theoretical risk of health effects. Because there's no such thing as zero risk, there's no such thing as zero exposure to chemicals. So when these quantitative health risk assessments have been done with synthetic, with styrene butadiene rubber and recycled tires, again, the risk estimates are not zero, but they're on the order of about 1 in 1 million. And 1 in 1 million is by sort of consensus among scientists and policymakers, a risk that's so low that it really is negligible. Or put another way, the risk is so low that if you try very hard to avoid it, you often end up causing some other kind of harm. So when toxicologists run these numbers and we find something this low, in our professional opinion, that means that the product should be decided upon on other grounds. In other words, the risk is negligible. And this finding seems to contradict something else that some of you may have read about. So I want to walk you through some other numbers. Some of you may know that about a year and a half ago, a soccer coach named Jimmy Griffin at the University of Washington in Seattle noticed something really striking. She noticed that there were 3 soccer players whom she knew, all of whom had come down with cancer. This was pretty surprising and pretty worrisome to her. And so she asked an obvious question, could there be a connection? And I should say, at the field that she coaches at, she's a goaltender coach, goalie coach, there is a synthetic turf system with chrome rubber. So she logically asked the question, I wonder if there's any connection. It's a perfectly sensible question to ask. After this became a national news story, parents and teachers and others started contacting her, and she now has a list of children or young adults who played soccer either on synthetic turf fields or partially on synthetic turf fields, and then later came down with cancer. So is there a causal connection or is this just a coincidence? Right, those are the 2 possibilities. So in order to determine whether it's just a coincidence or a causal connection, one needs to look at the numbers. And that's something that's happening right now. Dr. Kathy Wasserman, who's an epidemiologist at the Washington State Department of Health, is working through the numbers to determine whether the incidence is or isn't higher than expected. There's some preliminary data, and I'd like to share it with you. So I'm gonna walk through the numbers and keep a few in mind, but I can sum up afterwards. Washington State has a very good cancer registry, and that means that every time a health professional diagnoses a person with cancer, that health professional reports into the state, and the numbers are kept. It's sort of like a census for cancer patients. And these kind of data are very important, obviously, for tracking diseases that are as important as cancer. Now, the cancer registry has this data, and now we have Coach Griffin's list. On Coach Griffin's list are 45 soccer players whose home fields were synthetic turf, who were diagnosed with cancer any time over about a 15-year period from about, you need to know that it started in 2002, the cases were diagnosed as early as 2002 up to the present. So that's about a 14 or 15-year period. And the age of the patients was as young as 5 years old to as old as 24. Now, when we look in the cancer registry, you see that in the state of Washington, over that time period, for young people of that age, age 5 to 24, there's about 6,000 people with cancer, which seems like a big number because we think about cancer as mainly afflicting the elderly. But childhood cancer and cancer in adolescence, unfortunately, happens. It's pretty tragic when it does, obviously, you know, this is a serious disease, but it afflicts people of all ages. The elderly more, but people as young as 5 to 24. So in Washington State, over this time period with this age range, there's 6,000 cases of cancer in the registry. So now we have to ask, well, you know, about how many of those might have played soccer at some point before they got their diseases. So their data nationally, it turns out soccer is so popular that young people in the U.S., about 10% up to 20% of young people play soccer. So of that 6,000 cases, let's take the low end. Let's say 600 of those children or young adults were soccer players. So next, we have to know what percentage of fields in Washington State are synthetic and what percentage are natural. right? Because we're trying to see whether there's an unusual aggregation of cancer cases in the synthetic turf field players as opposed to the natural grass field players. So I asked various marketers and suppliers of synthetic turf for data on how many synthetic turf fields there are in Washington State. And the answer seems to be a little bit more than 400 such fields. There's an estimate you can make of how many fields there are in toto, both synthetic and natural, and that's about 4,000 in the state. So now we have an estimate that about 10% of the fields in Washington State are synthetic, most filled with drum rubber. So 10% of 600 cases is 60 cases, right? So if you follow me then, from the cancer registry data, given the age range of the patients of interest, given the fraction of young people who've played soccer, and given the fraction of fields in Washington State that are synthetic, we would estimate by coincidence alone, in other words, if there's no causal connection, you'd expect about 60 of those soccer players who have played on synthetic turf to have cancer, and about 540 of soccer players who played on natural grass to have cancer. So now we can compare the 60 expected cases with Coach Griffin's list, which has 45. Now, these numbers to a first approximation are pretty much the same number. We don't know the exact numbers. It's very hard to do epidemiology precisely in this kind of setting. But what that tells you, if you think about it, is that there doesn't seem to be an unusual aggregation or clustering of cancer cases in people who have played on synthetic turf. And since there doesn't seem to be an excess, then maybe there's no connection at all. Maybe it was just coincidence that Coach Griffin noticed what she noticed. You can't know for sure, but you can actually look at other investigations of cancer clusters. And if you think about it, I mean, we all know this statistically, things tend to get higher or lower kind of by chance, right? If you flip a coin, sometimes you get four heads in a row, doesn't mean the coin is weighted. So with regard to cancer in young people, the Centers for Disease Control, starting in about the 1960s, early 1960s, very extensively and exhaustively studied cancer clusters that arose in children. They looked at clusters of leukemia in a specific zip code, sometimes clusters of leukemia and lymphomas. They did about 100 such studies starting in the 1960s in young people. And it turns out, very frustratingly, in not a single one of those cluster evaluations was there ever an external cause found. There weren't any common chemical exposures. There weren't common exposures to ionizing radiation or radon or cancer viruses like human papillomavirus or HPV. It just seemed to be random chance. Now, it's not always true, of course. I mean, cancers do cluster in groups of people who are genuinely exposed to carcinogens. There are many things in occupational settings that genuinely cause cancer, and so when you see a cluster of cancer in some workers, sometimes it's because they were really exposed to carcinogens. Obviously, if you see a cluster of lung cancer in smokers, it turns out that's because smoking causes lung cancer. So does excess consumption of alcohol, for example, cause liver cancer and a few other kinds of cancers. So clearly, some clusters are causal, but others, and it turns out, unfortunately for science and for medicine, cancer in young people does seem to just occur spontaneously. Tragically, to be sure, but does seem to occur spontaneously, and that seems to be what's happening in Washington State as well. So if that's the case, then that does sort of comport with what we know toxicologically. Drum rubber is pretty much inert. Again, if you subject it to paint stripper, you can get pretty large amounts of a lot of chemicals out. But when you subject drum rubber to the kind of biological fluids that we create as human beings, it turns out that there's essentially nothing coming off, and essentially the same thing as what you'd get from urban soils or suburban soils. So as a toxicologist then, I'm left with the belief, and I have to say, not wanting to be too personal, but as a mother and grandmother, I'm left with the scientific conclusion that the choice of infills doesn't really turn on their toxicology and chemistry. I can turn on other things, how good it is as a sports surface, what the cost is, that sort of thing. But I can tell you that I've looked at this for a long time on behalf of schools and communities and the industry. And I should say I have done work for Shaw, who called me about a year ago and said, is there something dangerous about Perm River? Because if there is, we certainly don't want to be using it. So Lee mentioned that they do a lot of research and development at Shaw, and I can also tell you that they do care very much about the quality of stuff they use. And clearly, had I done the search and come back to them and said, yeah, you know, Perm River does look as if it emits too much of polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons or too much of a specific heavy metal, I think you should stop using it. I'm quite sure that they would. So I do think that it's important to look at these things from the point of view of chemistry and toxicology and epidemiology. I think you can't just stop and say, well, it's synthetic and therefore it's I don't want it. You could say that, but that wouldn't be based on what we know about the science. Based on the science, the New Jersey Department of Environmental Protection has concluded that these materials are fine. New York State DEC has as well, though I want to tell you about one exception. In New York City, there were some fields that had too much lead in them. And the reason, it turns out, is that years ago, lead chromate was a pigment that was used for some colors of some synthetic plastic grass, essentially. Lead chromate is not particularly stable in the environment, and it can, in fact, lead to relatively high levels of lead in fields. That was a problem. The industry hasn't used lead chromate in a number of years now, at least not in North America or Europe. I don't actually know about other places, and it may be that there's some lead chromate in other products, but certainly not in the US or North America or Europe for a number of years now. So there are exceptions, and it's important to look at the details. And that's something that I've done, that scientists in New Jersey have done, in New York, in Connecticut, actually. There have been some very good studies by the State Department of Health, Public Health in Connecticut, their state toxicologist, Dr. Gary Ginsberg, and their state epidemiologist, Dr. Brian Toll, have looked at this in great detail. There are studies ongoing right now. The California EPA is doing a multi-year, multi-million dollar study. And there's always more data that can be generated. But I can tell you as a chemist and as a toxicologist that I and others who have looked deeply into the chemistry of this don't expect that the new data are going to overturn the scientific consensus, which is, again, there are chemicals in these materials. However, the levels that migrate are so small that it turns out not to actually be a concern. So I'm happy, of course, to answer questions later, but that's kind of the objective and quantitative way to look at this material.
So that was a lot of information to absorb. So at this time, I think there's probably a lot of questions. I'll be happy to answer questions as it relates to design, I think Tim, SED, that sort of stuff. Lee would probably be best to answer questions specific to infills and turf systems. And obviously, Tasha Green would be best related questions to toxicology. So I'll pass over to you at this point.
Tested only, and I'm asking just because obviously that would be something to look at from a cost standpoint if that's not in good condition as far as an overall decision.
It's really hard to tell specifically what condition it is. There are certain features like drainage, like if you get deluge of rain and the field doesn't drain, or you're seeing changes in the way it's performing after rain, that's an indicator. kind of sloping to the both ends, that's how it drains. And typically you'll see like maybe differential settlement. You could run your eye down like the sideline and maybe you see like the sideline, you know, kind of dip. So I think there's a couple minor areas like that. But truly once the carpet is off, that's when you can get a better assessment.
And that was my question. We really can't tell until we get in there. I mean, there might be indications that Andrew or coaches might have noticed, but we really truly won't know until we dig deep.
Right, I mean, and I don't want to speak to Andy, if you got something to add, but other things that we looked at, there were a couple repairs, and, you know, it's worn out spots where the goalies are. There are physical areas that are
common. Extra wear areas. And then the other question I had is, and I think this was answered, but I'm just going to ask it to make sure I understood it correctly. When Dr. DeFreitas? I thought I'd make you feel better since you didn't want the picture. You mentioned the pad barrier, but that's, so I know that you dig up the infill. Do you get all of that infill that's out, that's there currently? Does that all come out? Is there some left behind where the pad helps protect it a little bit with whatever we put in?
No, the infill is sort of locked in the turf. Maybe some's going to spill out, but the way they do it is they'll come in and they've got machines that will cut it into strips and actually roll it up with the infill in it and then remove it. So, yeah, you may have a little bit of crumbs that are laying around from that process, but, yeah, nothing that damages the base. And just, these guys are the engineers too, but typically from what we see of doing hundreds of these fields a year is that very seldom do you have any problem with the existing drain if it was built properly. You'd sort of know now if it was draining slow. And so, yeah, I mean, you really don't know until you get 100% to get it up. But I think you'd know, in minor, that regrading price up there, that's for sort of a regrading of the whole base. But very likely you'd know if you had issues. But yeah, that turf comes up. Now, one thing I'll throw in on that infill is if you just, there is a little movement and a sustainability front to, if you're going back with crumb rubber, to they can actually separate the sand and the rubber and recapture some of that rubber and use a percentage of it. Now, the sizing is different than when it started, so we only use a percentage of it mixed with new rubber, save you a bunch of money, and you're really sustaining your investment originally and kind of sustaining to sustain. So there is, there is some reuse for that. They can actually pull that out first before they roll out the turf. So just something to kind of throw into the discussion.
And then the turf would have to physically be removed prior to the placement of the pad. So that's
right.
Thank you very much. And then the last question I have right now is, Dr. Green, you had mentioned Washington State has an excellent cancer tracking system.
They do, yeah.
Does New York State not have something similar that we would be able to look at any data on our area or this state?
I actually know nothing about New York State, whether it has a cancer registry, I'm sorry.
Okay, that's okay. I just thought I was curious on that. Thank you.
Maureen, please. Thank you. Some of the questions that have been raised is the heat factor coming off of the fields. So is there a difference in the heat from the organic to a rubber?
Yeah, I mean, there's no question that turf in general heats to a high level in ambient temperature than natural grass, and the black, the rubber, elevates that to some degree. And the solution has been, either keep the kit. And up in the Northeast, we don't have as much of an issue as the South, but the solutions have been to keep kids off at certain times when you hit a certain temperature, and I don't know what that exact temperature is, but I know districts have set temperatures. I don't know if yours has. So there is some of that, and there's been studies done where if you use colored infill, will that reduce the temperature? And Shaw actually did a study and found that really coloring the infill or doing something to fiber doesn't reduce it to a substantial amount, There's two solutions. One, the organic coconut will actually have a very similar temperature to natural grass and ambient temperature. Slightly elevated, but tracked very, very close. So there is a positive on that. On the black rubber side, the SBR rubber side, we invented or we developed a polymer that actually gets attached or applied to the rubber and it holds moisture in. So solutions for heat in some places was to water the fields down. So you have a hot day, field's hot, you water it, it cools it. But then, as you know, it can create steam and ramp up, and it actually can create a worse situation. So what this product does, it's called HydroChill. It actually holds the moisture down in the system, and kind of like the sweat in your body, it wicks it back very slowly over several days. So you do have to have water. We've always felt that, you know, having some source of water, but it's not a constant watering, and it's a very slow release. So we've seen temperature drops of 30 to 50 degrees using that. But
there is a lower temperature with the organic.
The organic does, yeah, at least the coconut, and then the other product is the EnviroFill. They're reporting not quite as high, but the studies I've seen are 10, 15 degrees lower than what the turf may get. But if it's, you know, that's the number to know. If the turf gets to 140, 150 degrees, and you know you're lowering it 10, 15 degrees, it's you know, no pun intended, not necessarily a game changer. That's where the HydroChill came in. But the GeoFill is, yeah, that's shown to, you know, to really be very close to natural grass at the temperature.
There were some questions brought about allergies with the organic.
Yeah, that comes up. I guess, you know, coconut is not in the nut family. It's I think it's in the vegetable family. I think it's and so it's we have not heard of any incidents. I forget what kind of vegetable it's related to, but it's not in the nut family. I think I have that where it's tied to a vegetable source, but we have known allergies to that material or reaction, I should say.
Anybody else? Rose?
Hi, thank you very much. I apologize for being late. I myself was out of work obligation. So I apologize for missing much of the presentations. I have a couple of questions, and I certainly am not going to ask them all now because I want to give the community a chance to ask as well. As I walked in, Dr. Green, you were talking a lot about how biological fluids might influence the, or might not influence the escape of chemicals from the turf. But what about the outgassing from extreme heat and the possibility of inhalation of these chemicals?
Yeah, it's a good question. California looked at that in, I think, in their 2010 study, because it's clearly something to think about. And so they went to the Central Valley in the middle of the summer. It was really hot, obviously. And they did this really cool experiment. They took a clean, brand new trash can, essentially, and put a probe in there, put the trash can on top. It got really hot. And they analyzed the air, and they really couldn't find much. The major thing that off-gassing is something called benzothiazole, which has actually been specifically assessed by Gary Ginsberg in Connecticut in his risk assessment. And it turns out that even though that's the prominent thing that comes off, but at very tiny quantities, and you can get a significant risk out of it. As you may know, it's the base of the number of pharmaceuticals. But in terms of the other materials, I mean, the other things in the rubber are either, metals, which of course are not volatile, or polysilicon and hydrocarbons, which are also not volatile, or the styrene-butadiene rubber, which of course is a polymer. So yeah, it's been tested. The other kinds of tests, which are actually even perhaps more useful, and these have been done in Italy and possibly other places, but I think in the accounting study, they've sampled the air over fields in, very hot condition when people are playing, and then sampled air in sort of the neighboring field. It was natural grass, but in the same environment. And they found what you'd expect, which is low levels of benzene and toluene and other things, which are mostly from, as you know, on the field exhaust. They couldn't find any significant differences in air quality. What they found is it was all reflected basically back and nothing else. So I think both of the trash can experiment and the, sort of environmental experiments, there really doesn't seem to be an obvious issue, which would make sense. I mean, the chrome rubber is from recycled tires, which have been in the environment, for a very long time, including the waste tires. So there really isn't much left to play about all this stuff. There's a little, but there's not much.
So I guess guess where I'm confused is that the ICANN School of Medicine at Mount Sinai, the Children's Environmental Health Center, under sworn testimony on February 16th, 2016, has made very strong recommendations based upon their assessments of the same literature that you've looked at, in which they say it is their recommendation that these products never be used as surfaces where children play. They say there are significant gaps in the evidence supporting the safety of recycled rubber turf products. They say children are uniquely vulnerable to harmful exposures of recycled rubber surfaces. One thing I didn't hear you speak about at all is the neurotoxicity, because it's not only oncologic processes, and also to I'll get to that question in a minute. They have immature detoxification mechanisms. There are a whole bunch of health issues that are particularly sensitive to developing children that many of the studies that you quote don't necessarily look at the unique vulnerabilities of children. The outgassing of the surface that the studies that you mentioned, what height was that taken at? Children have much higher respiratory rates than adults, especially when they're exercising, especially when they're on the fields. And so I guess I'm just confused how we can sit here and suggest perhaps that it is not as concerning as what health experts on the other side are saying. Their conclusion is, in the absence of convincing evidence of safety, we recommend that children not play on recycled rubber surfaces that contain known carcinogens and neurotoxins, and support a ban on the use of these products. And that was sworn testimony from less than a month ago. So how should I kind of combine these two differing opinions? I know you're not a health in the health domain, but how do I make sense of that?
Well, I think with respect to the folks at Sinai, of course, they're terrific pediatricians, but they're not chemists. And why would you study?
Well, they're
not chemists, and you don't learn about tires in medical school, obviously. And I don't know much about pediatrics, but what I can say is the assessment that's made there isn't based on what I think a scientist ought to do, which is look at the numbers. It's obviously true that kids are more vulnerable. It's obviously true that young kids are more vulnerable. It's obviously true that they breathe more, and athletes are supposed to breathe more. But as a scientist, when I look at health risks, I have to do it numerically. You won't find numbers in that testimony. I mean, I don't know, but you didn't give me any numbers, and I suspect it's because it's not there. For example, as I think I mentioned, styrene, which is a building block of the styrene-butadiene rubber, is a dangerous chemical. But once it's in the styrene, and it can be neurotoxic. But once it's bound up in a polymer form, it's completely bound. It's like baking a cake, and then there's no more raw egg, even though raw eggs can be dangerous with regard to microbial matters. So all I can say is that I and other chemists and scientists who looked at this, we are certainly not pediatricians, but our job as toxicologists and health risk assessors is to not just throw up our hands and say, it's got chemicals in it, we should look at it. Our job is to very specifically quantify. And I would say further, when I was first looking at this possible cancer cluster among athletes, the first thing I thought of, the first thing anyone should think of is air pollution. Because obviously, what athletes do is inhale a lot more air than those of us who are sedentary. And when you work through the numbers, the most important carcinogen in outdoor air is diesel engine exhaust. And when you further work through the numbers, the risks associated with inhaling more diesel engine exhaust are like a 1,000 times higher than anything you would get from anything. And so, if athletes are at increased risk of cancer, it's because they inhale a lot more air pollution, mostly diesel engine exhaust, CPS exhaust, and obviously they're exposed to sunlight, and so they should have sunscreen on. So, I mean, again, my job as a health risk assessor is not to stop at the qualitative part. Qualitatively, of course, they're dangerous chemicals in air, because there are in natural dirt. I mean, there's a lot more lead in most samples of dirt than there are in carbonate, for example. So you can't just do it qualitatively. And again, with respect, I know nothing about pediatrics, and I would submit to you that most pediatricians don't know a lot about the cancer of tires. Why do you know that?
So to answer some of those questions, because I think it's regrettable that they're not here themselves to respond to this. You know, one of the people who started this center, which is also sponsored by the CDC, is the person who broke the box open on lead poisoning. They are epidemiologists. They have basic scientists in this center. I don't think that they should be discredited as people that do not understand this, and they also sit on the Pediatric Environmental Health Committee. So I respectfully disagree that they are not experts on this. There is one thing also that I think is important, and you mentioned a lot about looking at quantitatively how much is the substance present in the air around where they breathe. Well, in pediatric health, there are genetic predispositions with double hit theories that if there is a second hit to a genetic predisposition, which could be a chemical, then that puts a child at a higher risk of whatever disorder it is that that genetic predisposition is for. It could be a neurologic disorder, it could be an oncologic disorder. And one of the problems with these chemicals is the multiple effects of not just one chemical, but multiple chemicals. And I think that's where health expertise is extremely important, because that is something that is of major concern. And the last thing I'm gonna say before I pass it on, although I have a lot more questions, is you mentioned that there is no link with leukemia and lymphomas in children between environmental factors. Now, for a fact, we know that EBV and Burkitt's lymphoma is linked. So I don't think that we can say that there is no link between environmental factors and leukemias and lymphomas, and I just want to make sure that we're clear about that, that there are links. Now, whether or not there are clusters or not, that's something that it takes time to demonstrate. And I agree with you, you can't just call and say something is a cluster without having sufficient data and sufficient information and tracking this. But cohort studies are things that we need to look at, not just quantitative assessments of how much is coming up. We really have to follow these patients. So thank you very much. I'll pass the mic.
I too would like to hear from members of our community as I frame my questions, but I would like to start off with a couple of concerns I share. One of them is the fact that the testimonial completely disagrees and contradicts anything I found in a full year of research I've been doing now on this topic. I did not find any other toxicologist specifically in your area of work who would testify that chrome rubber is safe for children to play on. So I'm very concerned that your position is very unique and different from anything I was able to locate. And it's been almost a year that I'm extensively researching this topic specifically. My other concern is the chemicals, as you know, because I had to study toxicology through the School of Public Health at Columbia. The chemicals are known as carcinogens and neurotoxins. No disagreement on that, I would assume, from a toxicologist's point of view. There's inhalation definitely as a risk, as well as ingestion. It does go in their mouth. And to just evaluate this based on bodily fluid is only one way of looking at it. There's the risk of inhalation, ingestion, and it actually goes into their eyes, and there's extended exposures through the household when the chrome rubber comes home in their shoes, in their clothes, and in their hair. So the exposure is over a lengthy period of time. So there's no question that these chemicals are there. We have a list of them that everyone will agree on, including the manufacturer. And there's no question that those chemicals have harmful effects on the human body. We did not need the Amy Griffin cluster to be the only indication of risk. The risk is known from a toxicologist point of view and a clinician point of view, and especially with the public health group that has just released this this testimonial. I'm also concerned because the federal government just started this massive research based on, I'm sure, evidence or lack of it, or disappointment at the research that's already been done, but it wasn't conclusive. So how do you feel about the federal government initiating a massive study to actually come up to a definitive conclusion? you know, making me feel that a definitive conclusion is not justifiable right now.
It's certainly true that there's studies on that. Frankly, the California EPA study is going to be a lot more extensive than the federal study. It is certainly true that more can always be learned, but it is not true that health officials have not concluded what as I mentioned, Dr. Gary Ginsberg spent a lot of Connecticut's taxpayer money doing published peer-reviewed studies, doing every health risk assessment analysis, chemical analysis you can, that's how we know about the environment. And it is simply the case that the numbers are too small. I agree entirely that we should protect our children and our children's health. Why would any of us go into that field? Okay, but I feel equally strongly that if you focus on something that is ministry and not what actually matters most for children's health, and as I said, outdoor air pollution is when you look through the numbers. I mean, I can't tell you how many communities I go to and people haven't even measured the radon levels in their schools or in their homes. If you work through the numbers, radon is a significant cancer risk. Diesel engine exhaust is a significant cancer risk. HPV, how many kids are still not vaccinated because their parents are worried about vaccines? I mean, it is my obligation to try to rank these things because, frankly, if you don't start with the most important stuff first, then you can't make progress. I can tell you, having worked through the numbers, it does not make any difference what the surface is. Children's health is going to be, there's no aspect of the field that, from any of the numbers, can make a difference. What makes a difference is the environment that they're playing in terms of what they're breathing. And what they're breathing is, unfortunately, still too much pollution. I mean, there's no question about that. It's better than it was when we were young. It's better now than it was in, you know, Pittsburgh or Los Angeles or Atlanta or Houston. But it's still a problem. And I can tell you, I'm working with the numbers, that the carbon rubber filtering is a distraction. It is not, in fact, important for children's health. And all I can say is, based on the data that I know to be the case, and based on the physical properties of carbon rubber, it is not neurotoxic. Styrene is neurotoxic. Styrene butadiene rubber is not. It's the difference between vinyl chloride, which obviously is an important toxic chemical, and polyvinyl chloride, which is plastic. So all I can say is it's a misunderstanding of chemistry.
Well, I have a list of the substances in chrome rubber that include VOC and SVOCs. These are clearly neurotoxins, proven neurotoxins beyond doubt. There are many others on this list. The lead is still there, even though you're stating dirt has lead as well. The zinc is there as well.
There is a lot of zinc.
Exactly, a lot of zinc.
Which is an essential
known and proven neurotoxin as
zinc.
Well.
Zinc is an essential nutrient. But in high levels, yeah, that's the point. The amount of zinc that comes out is completely non-toxic. I think we're just going to have to agree to disagree.
And quoting the Connecticut study, and I have great respect for the scientists involved in it, also concluded that further research is necessary and that there's no definitive conclusion that this substance is safe. And that's the Connecticut study you quoted, because I've had to read it several times.
Okay.
Actually, before I do that, I just have one question for my fellow board members, and that is just so that we have clarification here, and I do agree with Dr. Green that the chrome rubber fill is a distraction, and I think it's a distraction for us, because if I'm not mistaken, I believe all of us as board members agreed that that's not an option for us. Is that correct?
Correct.
That we were going to look at organic type of infill. No, but I'm just saying that with respect to that, right, but it's a distraction for us.
Yeah.
So let's get undistracted and... No, I mean, I can do that. But I just want to make sure that, right, that the seven of us are focused on the fact that, so the public understands that moving forward, our consideration for infill for this synthetic turf is going to be something of organic in nature, correct? Correct? I mean, yes? No. I'm getting the hook.
Tim, with respect to the pad that you use, if you use that pad, I forget what you called it, does that mean you use less infill, if I remember?
It changes the pile height, yes, it reduces
the
pile.
When you put a shock pad under the turf, it gives you flexibility to, so you have, let me put it a different way, the pad costs, you know, there's a cost to the pad that you're going to see, you know, $1.10. So it's those costs that you saw for different. I had different types of pads there, but you do get to now reduce the pile height, reduce the amount of infill, and reduce some of the costs there, and change the dynamics of the system a little bit. You're putting more of the shock absorbency underneath as opposed to in the system.
Right, and that doesn't necessarily affect the play of whatever game, like even football, soccer.
No, I mean there are pile heights that you would. I mean, we have, like, for example, FIFA level, high level, FIFA 2-star is the term, but fields that are 1 3/4 inches with a pad, the highest level. FIFA really has the highest level of testing is what we aspire to, more than the NFL does. So yeah, I mean you can still get the characteristic you need in a shorter pile.
Okay, and just a quick question about the coconut. I believe you said something about the coconut floating. We had a sample of it. We actually felt it. I'm sorry. So
one of the organics is cork. We could get it. We haven't embraced it. Now there's a small amount of cork in this coconut. It's 90% coconut and 10% minerals, which is a little bit of cork. It's in there for resilience, and it does in large quantities will migrate and float, which, you know, we think over time it's. And our study shows that the traction levels are of cork by itself are not what you want for a higher level athletic field. So yeah, it's more the cork as opposed to the coconut.
And when you say higher level, you're talking about football versus?
No, just traction levels in general for adequate sports play, I guess is the best way to put it.
Great, thank you. Thank you all. Okay, at this time I would like to, we're at 1.05, which is public participation. Again, public participation, we're doing a little bit differently today. This way the panelists can actually answer questions. So in an orderly fashion, please, if you can approach the microphone, there's one over there, there will be one over here, and ask a question to one of the panelists, if you could, whoever would be best to answer the question, just approach. The microphone here so that everybody else can hear you and speak up through their voices. Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation today. It's without a doubt that the synthetic field is much more cost effective than grass, as we mentioned earlier. But there's health concerns that, as parents, we have to be concerned about, especially for myself, who has a 10-year-old son who's played on a soccer field that you currently have down there for a number of years, for football as well as soccer. As you know, the chrome rubber that is currently there right now has 49 different chemicals, 7 are carcinogen. That's a lot. Even one is a lot. Not just that, as you mentioned earlier, the effects that it has on the irritation to your respiratory system, irritation to the eyes, neurotic, allergy, cancer, and that would be lymphoma. Dr. Green, I just want to mention something to you. I heard your presentation. But I came away with the effect that, well, you mentioned that, well, there's some chemicals, but our soil has chemicals. I don't know if that was the right way to put that, because one chemical is too many chemicals for most of us, because we don't want to be exposed to that, especially for myself, who has a child who plays on that field on a continuous basis. That's really important to me. But I just downloaded this thing for today from the Connecticut Artificial Turf Study, which you might be familiar with. In that study, they talked about how the report of lymphoma, you mentioned the Amy Griffin out in Washington State. I'm just reading from what she had mentioned on this study. The number of lymphomas in the population of athletes who played on synthetic turf collected is much higher than normally expected. This suggests that the athletes who have come down with lymphomas have played in synthetic turf for years may have all been exposed to the same chemical carcinogens like those found in rubber tire that we talked about earlier, okay? And they went on to say the percentage of lymphomas in the population of athletes who played on synthetic turf collect is much higher than other fields. Can you comment on that?
As I've been trying to say, it is certainly true. By the way, there's a lot more than 49 chemicals in rubber. I mean, there's not this. Yeah, of course. What I'm trying to say is that as a quantitative matter, those chemicals come out either not at all because of the vulcanization process. I mean, look at your tires. They are pretty sturdy. And when they wear as little particles. Okay? They don't disintegrate. It's important to think about. Just as I said before, styrene dyeing is the base of chewing gum. I mean, these materials don't disintegrate. They are essentially inert, not entirely, because nothing's entirely inert, but they're essentially inert. So it doesn't matter what is in the matrix that you can't be exposed to, whether you eat it, whether it's on your skin. And there was a very good study done, for example, of Italian athletes who rolled around in this stuff. Rugby or something, and they had, you know, black crumb rubber all over themselves. And they were studied extensively to see whether they absorbed more polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, which are the chemicals of most concern. If they, you know, it's what's in charcoal boiled steak and stuff. And there wasn't any difference in their blood levels or their urine levels because it's not bioavailable. Now, in terms of whether there's more or less lymphomas in soccer players on synthetic turf versus natural turf, we don't have that data. That data doesn't exist. Kathy Wasserman is trying to get that data. That's the whole point of her study. But there's nothing that's available yet on that. And as I mentioned, sadly, although obviously there are some kinds of lymphoma that are caused by viruses, sadly, lymphomas in children don't seem to have external causes. They have some viral causes, but they don't seem to have chemical causes. So I can only tell you what the science says. I know that it's scary.
Okay, we're here talking about moving forward, putting EPDM on there. Now,
right, so
is there enough
anyway.
Is there enough study that's been done about that? Are we going to come back here in 5 years and talk about, oh, you know what, we forgot to mention we have more chemicals, so now we've got to rip the field up again and put something in. Is there enough study been done on that to move forward with that decision?
There certainly are fewer chemicals in EPDM because it's not EPAH, it's in tires, come from extender oils that are used in the tire building process.
But it's a new process, though.
I'm sorry?
It's a new process.
EPDM, no, it's been around for
a long time. No, it's been around, but it hasn't been used on lead fuels.
I think it has for a fair amount of time.
Going back at least 20 years.
On a small basis, though, not as large scale as what you're proposing.
Yeah, I mean, I would say about EPDM, it has to be a good domestic or North American source, because there are some EPDMs that are made in other countries that turn out not to be very good in terms of melting.
I have a couple questions, actually. I've been sitting here for an hour and a half, and I see all of these choices on here for replacing our fields. But yet, in the last 15 minutes, I've heard that no crumb rubber infill is an option at all to replace our fields. Is that correct or is that not? Is that an overall yes? So what options on this slide are no longer part of our options? So that doesn't include coated rubber, doesn't include EPDM rubber. What is eliminated on that slide? Anything? But I thought we just said we're not doing crumb rubber info. Maybe I heard wrong, but if someone can please. Then what options on that slide are no longer valid?
Just understand if the questions are for the
catalyst, and they, they're taking their time today, and thankfully we're here to present for us. We appreciate you coming. We haven't seen, this is the first time we saw this slide.
Okay.
So as far as saying, I've coated rubber, you know, some of the items on there, you know, can't be put on the spot right now, so we're gonna never coated rubber, never, you know, we haven't seen a lot of this. So it's kind of hard for us to say, and now, without us having a discussion about it, what we will and will not do. So I just want to preface that to a certain extent.
Okay, that's fine.
However, we have had discussions with respect to rubber.
Because she spent a long time talking about something, which may not even be an option. So I'm a little bit confused as to what I can do.
I'm concerned also about what's on the fields now.
Okay, but we know they're coming off.
Correct.
The fields have what they're doing.
I'll try to address that. So the options that we have up here are, this is, we're trying to inform everybody about what the options are and then what the cost might be, what the possible health impacts might be. So the focus, I think, is being derailed towards the chrome rubber conversation. It's not that there's anybody's trying to force chrome rubber as the new replacement on the field. It's, here's the options. We're trying to inform you about life cycle costs, possible health costs, maintenance costs, and then allow the board and the community to digest that information to make a decision on what might be best to move forward for the district.
So then I would come to a logical conclusion. There'd be another forum that I could attend that would give me the actual options they have chosen that I am going to be voting on.
I can't speak for the board, but I would assume so.
And I would also appreciate, if we do have another forum, that another health expert with a little bit more experience in the organic fill options is available to answer our questions. Because as far as Dr. Green is concerned, I don't feel that she has the overall expertise to answer detailed questions about every single infill option. So I personally, as a taxpayer and a mother of four kids who play on these fields, would like to have more information before I make my final decision. Thank you.
Just to go along the lines of what you had just said, is what's important is, even though we're using now the word organic infill, that doesn't mean that this is regulated, that this has ever been tested. So just because something says organic, that should also be, you know, very well presented to us in terms of whatever it is that's going to be filled in.
Hello. Dr. Green, I'm just wondering, I didn't see the slide so well, my eyes aren't perfect. As to your study or your toxicology center, I'm just wondering, who funds the majority of your research?
I don't do research anymore. I did do research when I was at MIT. This lecture in environmental toxicology for 15 years, 25 years actually. I do no longer do research. I do consulting for the US EPA, for the state of Massachusetts, for private companies, for interest groups, for groups that live near hazardous waste sites and are interested in technical expertise. I have a variety of clients, I always call it as I see it.
I'm just surprised, along the lines of what Dr. Maris was saying, is that it seems like all of the other studies that people have been reading about are that there are perhaps considerable health effects on the children. So I'm not a chemist, especially you are as a toxicologist. I'm not an oncologist. I'm a parent with three boys who play on these fields all the time. And my pediatrician, I have to trust their judgment. I can look at the numbers from a bunch of studies and I can say that, you know, my son probably has a 1 in 1,000,000 chance or less of getting polio, but these fine people on the board require that my sons have polio shots before they attend school. So I think the doctors at Mount Sinai are certainly well respected, and to hear their concerns about not recommending that children play on this, I need to really pay attention to that. I need to trust the experts that I trust with my children, and that would include the pediatricians and the members of this board. So I hope that we'll all look into this a little bit further, and perhaps come away from the more questionable sources of from, and perhaps be along the lines of more organic. Thank you.
About 13 years ago, I was involved in the research and the touring the various facilities before our synthetic turf was put in as a member of the board. Obviously, much has come to light in terms of the ingredients and potential effects. And of course, we did not know of that then, back then, just like when people started smoking cigarettes years ago, they didn't know what the impact of that would be. Be that as it may, obviously, to err on the side of caution and safety is paramount for our kids. If there's an option that provides for a healthier alternative in terms of the infill, then clearly that's a way to go. There's no question as to how cost-effective it is. The fact that our community makes maximum use of these facilities. Going back 10 years ago, the goal was to provide quality, good facilities, athletic facilities that were representative of our athletic talent. And clearly there is a tremendous difference between, let's say, playing on this kind of a field versus natural grass. You know, and I know that that may not be an option. I'm not sure if that was ever mentioned about going back to that. I can attest to that working at another school that does not have these kinds of facilities and this kind of turf. And I think one of the major concerns that comes out of that is concussions. And that is also paramount in this day and age. So if you go to some kind of a surface that in the wintertime gets extremely hard, and the kid goes down on a tackle and bangs his head, I think whatever alternative there is that would be the safest is a much better option in terms of safety for the kids overall. So that's something that I would have a concern about. And in terms of the heat, I know that there are regulations as a coach in terms of certain temperatures outside that would restrict kids from even going on the field. So ideally, I would hope, I don't know what the temperature outside has to be in order for the synthetic turf to be of a certain temperature that would warrant kids not to be on there. I don't know if you can answer that question, but I know that I believe that if it's 85 degrees, then we are required as coaches and as responsible individuals representing our schools to make sure that our kids are not out on that field. So that, I don't know how often or if that would even come into play, but that would be something that I would want to know about, if that in fact has an effect and if there is X amount of heat, which I know comes out of that turf, but would the kids be on in the first place? Thank you.
Hi, I'm very grateful for the presentation tonight. And I just do have a question, Dr. Green. Are you here as a consultant employed by Shaw or CPL? I'm not really clear on how you came to be here this evening. So you're not here, you have not done work for Shaw before?
Oh, I have done work for Shaw, yes. Okay. I think I tried to say that before.
Okay, I wasn't clear.
They were concerned about whether Chrome Harbor was or wasn't something that they should.
So you've done other presentations for them on this issue?
Well, not presentations exactly, but I've certainly...
Analysis?
Yeah, I've certainly tried to help them understand the material.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
You know, just for future record, I would love it if we could have like a more diverse, you know, we have a manufacturer here, we have architects here, I would love to see more medical experts here because that's the scope of what we're all really worried about today. So my question is, if crumb is not a problem, and why are we removing it? Why aren't we either adding to it or putting down the padding? I'm sort of feeling like there really is a problem with it if we want to remove it. Otherwise, why isn't there some method of encasing it or putting the padding over it? Again, I'm not an architect, so maybe you can address that. And so that I'm understanding the health risks, what you're saying is from the studies that have been done, the cancer rate is incidental because it's sort of like this is what the general cancer rate would be amongst children of this age group. So can we expect that if we looked at bowling teams across the country that proportionately there would be the same rate of cancer? And I think it's a realistic question.
Well, I mean, nobody's ever looked at bowlers, right? But it seems as if there is no causal connection or even statistical connection. And that's why I tried to run through the numbers. As has been discussed, in your community, you've had firm rubber for a long time, and what I wanted to convey is that from a scientific point of view, I don't think parents or teachers should be worried that, you know, they've made a mistake or that somehow this is important for their kids' health, because as a scientific matter, it's not.
I don't think the longitudinal, I mean, as little as I know, I don't think longitudinally we've seen enough time go by. But to say there's not a direct cause doesn't mean there isn't a correlation. Like, I do think we should be studying our basketball players and the rate of cancer amongst the basketball players who don't use the turf as well. So, I am also concerned about the ingestion pathways of how this, you know, we've talked a lot about body fluid, is it like asbestos where there's friability, where this stuff has been in the ground and starting to dry out, which goes back to my question is why can't we encapsulate it? Why does it have to be taken out? Does it go into our the lungs and is it absorbed some way, even though, you know, it's technically not? Chemically, I don't know if I'm saying it right. Friability is all I can think of because I know about asbestos a little bit. So why can't we encapsulate it? And also, can I assume that there's no leaching off the field into the groundwater when we either leave it in place or start to dig it up?
I mean, I'll answer the question about the turf. I mean, you're just like your carpet at home, the turf is wearing out, so it's over time it compacts and the fibers are degrading from UV. UV is the biggest killer of this stuff over usage. So really as the pile height, you know, started at 2.5 or 2.25, it's now decreased to 1. As the pile height gets less, there's less material in there for shock absorbency. So it's really a function of the turf more than it is the infill. As I said earlier, you could really in theory pull that infill out and separate it and clean it and actually use some of it if you wanted, if you were going back to that. We actually usually get rid of the sand and save the infill, but it's you're replacing more of a function of the turf. You mentioned encapsulate. I mean, if you know, going back, that is, again, it sounds like it's not an option, but there in the industry there is an option of coated rubber that some feel that if encapsulating it is a solution or to again the perceived issues with it. So that would be more on the replacement side that's available. But yeah, what's out there is being replaced.
You just can't add more to it.
No, because the turf is just worn out. It's just the fiber itself is just worn. The seams start to separate. It's been out there 12 years. I mean, think about, you know, putting anything out in the environment for 12 years. You guys have done, you know, you've gotten a great return on your investment for those initial fields to have it out there this long.
I have a couple of questions. First is, I heard we have like 2,000 playing hours we're expecting to get out of our fields. Is that correct, Mr. Puccioni?
Yes.
And I've heard over and over again that grass is not durable compared to that. I'm just wondering, what is the relative, what could we expect to get out of natural turf?
In my discussions that I've had, I would say 500 to 600 hours.
500 to 600 hours, yes. So one quarter as much as what?
It would probably be limited mostly to just competitions, and we would likely not be practicing on those fields to preserve them for the competitions.
And what happens to the practice fields now that are natural? Are they grass or natural turf? I've heard that there's a difference in distinction, one is more durable than the other.
As far as I know right now, they're all just grass. They're not laid out specific sod. We've had sod certain fields, but for the most part, it's all just regular.
Okay.
grass.
So are we basing the durability of the field hours that we would get on natural grass or natural turf, which has come a long way in the past 10 years?
And my understanding is natural turf.
On natural turf. Yes. So that's the most you could really realistically expect to get about 1/4 of the playing time.
Yes. I mean, just on my own personal experience, I was at North Rockland for 12 years, and they have specific fields that they only compete on, and they're not allowed to practice on, and thus they always work out around those fields. They're always ready. They drain well. We would be yelled at as coaches if we went on there during practice because they need to preserve the fields as much as possible. And those are very good fields, specifically the lacrosse soccer field at North Rockland High School, and the same situation would likely occur here. And those are pretty new fields. They laid those out about 9 or 10 years ago, and they have very good shape. But still, the usage is very limited to ensure that the teams can compete on them and get all their games in.
So primarily based on the durability, we have ruled out natural turf as an option. Is that correct? And know that you guys are really not willing to speak at these meetings, but it would be so much easier to ask questions if I knew what to ask questions about. Like, I have a whole thing here on crumb rubber that I'm not going to waste anyone's time on if we've already decided that we're not going to use crumb rubber. It's a complete waste of everybody's time.
Well, I can add some other things. You talked about your initial infrastructure. That's with the concrete curb and the stone and the drainage that's all in place out there. So if we were going to change just the carpet to another synthetic turf system, you have the framework ready. If you were going to switch to the natural field with sod and what have you, this whole, I call it the section, the whole design basically has to get thrown out. And we got to start with a new design. We got to redo the drainage. We have to add a sand mixture, a topsoil mixture. Then you're talking about sodding probably, because you're going to lose the field probably for a good part of a year. And by the time this lasagna gets rebuilt, the sod puts in place, you got to let that rest in and weed in, and you know, you're losing it easily a year without a field whatsoever. And then at that point, you start with the reserve use and you're at the mercy of the weather. So
because we have the infrastructure in place, based on whatever info we choose, how long will this renovation take to get?
They could probably do it within a month, 30 days and start.
That's great. And I've also heard a lot lately about these pads in athletic fields. And I just read a little blurb about something, about a new pad that is, they're touting may reduce concussions or impact injuries on the fields. Is that what you've already presented to us, or is there new technology in that field?
Yeah, I mean, pads have been around for a long time. In fact, you know, all the original carpet style fields had pads in them. So there was always this misperception that the turf was right on asphalt, which it wasn't. It was always on a very shock absorbent pad. And contrary to belief, but yeah, pads have been around a while. There's different types. I showed you a foam pad. There's rubber sheet goods. There's paved in place rubber. All have a price point to them. And
are any of them organic?
Are they organic? I don't think so. I don't think true organic. But they're down under the turf. I mean, you have bound rubber. You have the one I showed you is basically recycled foam, much like. Probably recognize that. I mean, not exactly the same, but in every probably home in America, the carpet is a patch. This is just a little different structures. Polyethylene foam, very inert, and it's designed so the water drains through it. But there's several options of these in these boxes here. There's another type of foam that's a more rigid foam. It's called a rock pad. You can go on their website, rock. Rock.com, extensive research and study. They're one of the best at studying concussions and safety of pads. This is called Schmidt's pad. You can go on their website. So a lot of data on pads. Not necessarily, if you go with a resilient material other than organic, you don't necessarily need a pad. But, as I said earlier, I'd never argue against a pad. I just think, again, upfront cost, but the return on these is tremendous. And just, peace of mind for one, but, protecting your kids long term and with discussions. Take the whole infill issue out of it. These pads just, because of their longevity, just bring kind of lock in the properties of turf more than just by the infill itself, by alone.
And do we currently own all of the equipment in Rockport Central that we need to maintain these fields? I've heard that we need a turf brush and that we need to disinfect it periodically according to the environmental presentation we had last year. And I'm just wondering, have we done all that and do we have all of that we need to keep these fields as safe as possible?
I'm not qualified. I wouldn't say this to make that, but I can write it down. If you email me, I can certainly come find an answer within 48 hours.
And finally, I want to thank all of our guests for coming today. I also am a little concerned that we have only Dr. Green's perspective. I respectfully say that there's a toxicology report in here from a toxicologist who differs with your opinion, and all of the letters from Mount Sinai and the medical centers who were coming to present to us or were willing to come to present to us are in here. I have about 30 packets or so if any parents want to take this information with me, come see me. But I won't waste any more time discussing it since rubber crumb is off the table. I hope also off the table comes any form of rubber crumb, including virgin crumb, which is basically the same stuff.
Hi. Could we please have the slide back up that shows all the different types and the prices, please? And so I'm not sure exactly which specialist should answer, but there was a slide that said crumb rubber. Keep going. There. So, just to be clear, and I do thank Detective Detective Wong for reframing us and moving away from crumb rubber. Coated rubber, EPDM, which you said is in NIAC, TPE, and the Nike grind. Are those options just the same chemical compound as crumb rubber, but just shaped differently or coming from a different manufacturer?
No, those are all different types. Coated rubber, yeah, coated rubber is SBR rubber that's...
Is that the crumb rubber?
That's crumb rubber. So I'm thinking that's off the table because it's SBR that's acrylically coated and sealed. EPDM is the virgin rubber.
What is the difference, Kim? What's the difference? We've heard that virgin rubber is the same material. It's just never been used for anything.
It's actually been used in fields for about 20 years. Dr. Green,
if crumb rubber is
it's not a recycled tire.
So it's the same, it's made from the same stuff, it's just never been used for something before it's been put in the field.
No.
It's a different polymer.
It's different.
It doesn't have any of the, it's not vulcanized, doesn't have zinc oxide, which is used across the It's a much simpler compound. It's not a recycled material.
Okay. Many of the roof membranes in the district are EPDM rubber.
Okay, so that's would you say that's a common material used in schools and office buildings, homes, EPDM?
For
roofs.
Very common.
Okay.
Your running tracks, it's something we always forget is the running track your kids run all day, it's either SBR or EPDM. Many of them, if they're red, they're SBR bottom, but they're coated with the APDM derivative spray on top. Been around in a lot of uses.
And you guys were clear, the Nike grind option really is not an option that you feel very firmly.
I was going to throw in my opinion out there. I mean, there's some schools in Jersey, for example, that have just spent it in or are putting it in. I think that and it says or equal because there's this perception because the word Nike's up there that Nike is behind this and supporting this, and it really isn't. It's initially one of our competitors got to use the Nike swoosh for using the recycled material, and to their credit, I think it boosted them early on. But basically, what happens is there was one guy, one agent, let's put him, that was getting these Nike sneakers and having them chopped up and used. So Nike was really just selling the material, allowing their name to be put on them, and it was used for floors and then some of the sources, very limited source. But it was again this perception that when you look at the chemical report, it has a lot of the same chemicals as SBR. So I mean, from it was just the issue that we had with it at Shaw is that it's more the perception that it's better than SBR because it comes off of sneakers. Well, it's got some of the same stuff, and it's less regulated. I mean, we believe less regulated.
Thank you.
If anybody's, go ahead.
Oh, sorry, just one last question. So, in terms of the geofill and the envirofill, and Andy, I might put you on the spot for this one. Obviously, they cost more money, but in terms of the long-term care, maintenance, practice, and contest hours, and just quality of play, are they good options?
Well, let me start with the Envirofill. The Envirofill is probably the most more inert of the two. Again, I have samples up here, and I certainly get people to come up and look at them. But it's basically around it's mined in a few specific places. It's in a mine in Texas and in Ohio. It's called a frac sand. They used to use it for cleaning oil tanks. It's almost like a little BB, and then you seal it, and it. And what happens is it slows down. You know, all sand will, we see it at the beach, sand will start to fracture and compact. Well, it reduces the compaction, so it's this little round, you know, it's like putting marbles in a jar. You can only get so many in there. So that's the idea of it, that it's firm because it's sand, but it doesn't go through the compaction that regular sand does. And you need a pad because it's firm. But yeah, I think it's a viable option for fields that maybe have lacrosse, field hockey, sports that like a dead ball bounce. We just sold one in New York City for a Gaelic football field, and part of it had to do with, that's the product that actually New York City's using now. So there's, you know, tens of fields going in the city.
But our kids play football.
And because there's a pad, you could play football on it.
My
feeling is that it would be just a little firm. You have impact safety, like this, and then you have how something feels, you know. So there's two different things. I mean, from a football standpoint, you know, we got to definitely have the impact, but we also like it to feel a little bit of give. You know, the coach was talking about the frozen ground kind of. You know, we all want that good feel. There's sometimes confusion over impact and feel. The Geofill is as I said, ground up coconut. Again, it's up here. You know, again, everybody's welcome to file through and look. I'll open up the bag. It's very much like dirt. They feel fantastic. You know, go to Pleasantville; they'll welcome you over there. Walk around on it. It feels as close to natural grass. Very firm feel to it, which really most of our sports at a high level want. They want a feel that's not abrasive, but they want firmness. Football. Or soccer. We did some of the World Cup fields in Canada for the Women's World Cup. Those fields are tremendously firm, but they're also, you know, need a certain shock absorbency and have a certain unabrasive feel to them. But
and is the maintenance more over time? Well, is the cost just up front?
Yeah, no, there is. Envirofill, really not. It just kind of sits in the system. It's very heavy and really no different than regular infill. The Geofill does. The organics, such as the coconut, they do have a little bit of decomposition over time, not as rapid as people will think, and then it also compacts a little more. It'll dry out when in dry weather. It'll compact a little bit more. So there's maybe a little bit more intensive maintenance just from the brushing standpoint. Just a little more than normal, and then because you do lose a little bit over time for the compaction, every 2 to 3 years we're finding. You might have to add a quarter inch to a half of an inch. So there's an investment long term, but certainly a lot less than natural, but more than the turf that you have now.
And could you get the amount of hours?
No question. Yeah, great. No question.
Thank you.
Yeah, that wouldn't change at all.
I wasn't going to out myself, but since somebody brought it up. I am a pediatric neurologist, and I also have my master's in public health. And I apologize, actually, I haven't had a lot of time to review all the papers out there on the number, and now that opinion has changed. I have been in contact just recently with Jerry Paulson, who is the immediate past chair of the American Academy of Pediatrics Council on Environmental Health, who has shared with me some of the papers that have been going around that we've been talking about, as well as the Mount Sinai consensus. Obviously, I see a lot of neurotoxicity, I see a lot of concussions, so for me, knowing that my child is playing on a safe field in both aspects, as well as everybody else in this school district, is very important to me, and I really would not want our children to be part of a huge epidemiological study, as is going on in Washington. So, it would have been really nice to hear from the other side of the coin as well, the doctors from Mount Sinai.
Justice provided to them, Austin suffering. I'm a little confused, honestly, and disappointed that we're still talking about Crumb Rubber a year later. I think the, I thought the Board of Education last meeting voted that we're not even discussing it anymore. I know there's a salesperson here, as a salesperson myself, I respect what you do, but I don't think you're aware that the voters were clear last year, no crumb rubber. I think it's a disgrace that after 2 years, there's still not one medical professional who live in New York City that come and talk to this board and address the issue. I think it's a joke and a disgrace. As someone that has a young daughter who's 5 years old and a young son who's 11 months old that will be playing on these ball fields over the next 15 to 18 years, I'm really appalled, honestly, that after 2 years of hearing that we have not heard from a medical professional. We don't live in the middle of nowhere. We live in New York City. So the leading experts in the world are here. And the fact that we can't get someone here is a joke, to be perfectly frank. And as I said, I'm very confused because I think everybody in this room was under the understanding that crumb rubber was voted no clearly at the last board meeting. So the fact that we're still discussing this makes no sense to me whatsoever. And just to be very clear, if this school board puts crumb rubber on the ballot again, then we vote it down. And the fact that we're here for 6 weeks from election day and we're having this meeting, this should have been in January. And I think that is really offensive, honestly, that you're going to push this down to the voters' throats in 6 weeks when it's not ready for the voters at all, in any way, shape, or form. And I don't think that the school board could properly rule on anything unless it's a medical professional. I think it's offensive. And as a parent, I think that it's highly appropriate that before anything's voted on, we get a medical professional here. Thank you.
Respect. I think this board deserves to hear from the other side of the coin, if you will, as to from an epidemiological standpoint, as to what the other effects may be from playing on crumb. I feel though this entire presentation tonight has been somewhat of an orchestrated marketing campaign towards crumb rubber, and I think that's been voiced by some earlier speakers. We were told in the beginning that there's a number of options that are available. It could be grass, it could be synthetic. And then it became clear that synthetic was a better option. And then among the synthetics, it became one of the speakers announced that the SBR was the obvious choice. And then Dr. Green got up and spoke and mentioned that SBR, the crumb rubber, is really not harmful. So I think we've been kind of led down the road of thinking that this SBR is the way to go. I'm very reluctant to believe just one contractor, one firm, one organization with such a large investment and a long-term investment in that we're charging into this very quickly and not very thoughtfully. My other main question to the board really is how does this process work in terms of how long does it take to get such a thing to be voted upon? How much time needs to pass between the passing of a referendum and the selection of a contractor? This all seems to be, it seems to be not addressed for quite some time. And now it seems there's a big rush to get it done. I don't have any answers to that, but I think a little more forthcoming information from the board would be the more.
Issues with ordering, like anything?
Yeah, usually from what we call shop drawings. So that means, you know, that after it's approved, we would draw up a draft of the lines and, you know, the field layout, and from that time to the delivery of the turf, you're probably looking at 2.5 to 3 weeks. But you've got a week of removal, and so some of that time, as the turf being made, other things can be going on to prepare the base and the fields for the new turf.
I mean, it's pretty fine if you're going to replace the sports out of there, the inlay, the lines that go with it. I mean, we're not going to change anything. It's pretty much what you see. I know there's talk about adding a logo or maybe colorizing the end zone. Some of that is like color decisions that need to be made. But truly, I think, you know, we could have it ironed out in 30 days. When you say, oh, you're going to tell us, say, who you're going to select off the list. We would coordinate with them. Saw some of the square footage measurements, we'd probably want to resurvey that. They would probably want to double check on it. And then there's the shop drawing, so we can finally say, this field does dip across and what have you, this one is softer and what have you. So we all agree in writing that these are the sports, these are the lines that are going to get installed.
And is there a certain time of year that, so over the summer, this could potentially happen over the summer?
They can do it probably up until when it snows. I mean, they have the lights that work nights, or be a premium probably for night labor, but I I think you'd want, most schools want to work around like a homecoming schedule. You don't know how many we've done where it's like, you know, hurry up and try to get done. The contractor leaving out the back door and the homecoming team's coming in the front door.
Is this expected that's to go for a vote in May? Is that the plan?
And sir, I'm sorry you took away that we were pushing Crumb Rubber. We're not. As your consultants for the district, we understand it's a broad spectrum decision, and we just brought all the cards to the table. We are not promoting
one. I felt it was definitely swayed towards the
I'm sorry you took that away.
Yeah, I mean, I'd like to just throw on top of that. I mean, when I did this pricing, obviously I got Crumb Rubber up there, but you know, you've got other options, and I think what we tried, what Tim asked me to do, is try to give an order of magnitude. And you know, at Shaw, you know, we did bring, our R&D department did bring Dr. Green on for our peace of mind, so we could, you know, relay peace of mind to our customers. And so we took that step, and, you know, we agree, I think, to the most part with the studies that are out there. And I'd like to thank Dr. Green's presence here tonight is not only, as she said, for, you know, what you may buy in the future, but it's also you're playing on it now, and no matter what you do here, you know, I would say 8 out of 10 fields that you're going to play on, that your kids play on, are still Crumb Rubber. So I mean, so I'm hoping that maybe some of that, there's some, you know, relieving of the concern about that possibly by Dr. Green's presence, because it's out there. But and again, your kids are going to be mostly on your fields. But we try to give an order of magnitude and what the ramifications were and what each of them were, because we pretty much thought that, you know, as the general public, you know, people hear SBR rubber or Crumb Rubber, but what are the other options? And that's pretty much, for the most part, all that are out there available. So we, again, as Tim said, broad spectrum.
Let's use 90 days as a reasonable estimate, because you have to take into account whether you don't want to run a job. This is like a craftsmanship. They're actually installing it, so you want a good job. So I would say you could set 60 as a goal, so 90 years.
Is that Shaw Sports on the New York State Approved Contractor List? Is that one of the people that we would be looking to if we chose to go with an artificial?
Yes.
And how much play is there in the numbers amongst your competitors that are also on the New York State Contractor List? If we decide to go with EnviroFill, I mean, that's a big number. Are we going to save some money by shopping around, or are you the lowest? Is that the lowest possible price we can get?
You know, this was an estimate based on historical data. We actually went out and got numbers for the removal. We, you know, without doing a full-blown estimate, you know, these are probably a moderate pricing. I mean, they're not real high and they're not super low. So, I mean, for this exercise, we went in and took, we took the install rates from around here, Pleasantville, that we just did field. So, you know, When you go to state contract, I mean, there's some benefits to that. And one of them, there is a set price list that you go off of, but you are allowed to negotiate down off of that. And you also have to understand that the expedited time is a savings. And where you save a huge amount is in contractor markup, because many times if you put these out to bid, especially in an expedited fashion, you know, general contractors may bid it for the removal and the grading part of it, but they're going to take any component, the turf or the pad, and put a markup on it. So, you know, state contracts are, you know, there's a lot of benefits to them other than just pricing. There's, you know.
So I'm clear, we are going to have to stay within a price range. I didn't quite understand what you said. With the state contractor, there is a set price range.
Yeah,
it doesn't really matter who we pay.
Yeah, the way cooperative purchasing works is that you have there is a established price list that's nationally based for the most part, and it sets a threshold of pricing. And then, for example, the reason that's done is that you have different wage rates. For example, you know, this project in New York City would have a much higher cost because of the wage rates and unions, and you know, where you're forced to pay union scale or union benefits, things like that. And then here would be prevailing wage, and then you have private wage. So, or this, your project in, you know, out in the middle of the state would be less for them. So you got to set a threshold. You can't go over it, but you can certainly estimate that. So when we work on a co-op, we actually bid the job. We don't go by the price list. We estimate your job as it would be, you know, just as if we were bidding the job. So you do get a competitive price based on that.
But by staying with an approved New York State contractor, we will have multiple options to choose from. We'll get multiple bids.
You could
do that?
We could.
You guys are on the list. If they're on the PAP.
With regards to this slide up here, are the, it was mentioned that perhaps we don't have all the, the word utensils, but that's the wrong word.
Equipment
necessary for maintenance. So do these prices, and you told us EnviroFill does not require much maintenance equipment. So is it safe to assume that the other ones have an additional cost to
the equipment
that we need to purchase?
Yeah, the maintenance is all similar. The maintenance on these synthetic fields, the basic piece of equipment is called a greens groomer. It's a metal rack. Do you have one now? It's nylon, stiff nylon brushes on a rack that's run hydraulically. You pull it with your golf cart. It costs $2,700. I mean, so you would have, in the scheme of these things, it's really an insignificant. Typically, it's included in most specs. You'd line out of it in there. Some schools that are replacing have them, but in the magnitude of these numbers, it's a $2,500, $2,700 item, but it lasts a really long time. You just drag it, it's a brush. Now you can get into some more expensive sweepers, but really that's all you need is this little greens groomer. You have a gator now?
If I can save you a lot of energy. They have the equipment to do it. They currently do groom it. They could groom it more frequently. You know, as they say, you could do more, but in reality, it does get groomed every year. They have the gators to pull it. They've got the brooms to do it, and it gets done.
All right.
Hi, I have a question for the board, really. If the vote was to go up, I guess, the May 17th, I believe that's the budget, when would this wording and decision have to be made for by the board, and the board approved to go up for the referendum on May 17th? Is there like a 45-day window? Is there a certain number of days that this has to be?
Normally, you have to, I can answer that, I think, it's not an attorney, but you got to go through SEAKER, it's the State Environmental Quality Review Act, and this, because you have a synthetic field, and you'd be just basically replacing it, it'd be probably a type 2 action.
My question is more for the community to approve it. So we have to put it, I'm assuming the community is going to approve the service that the board puts up. So my question is, if the vote is May 17th, when does the wording have to be approved?
So playing a little bit of devil's advocate, say something comes up for a vote, it gets turned down by the community for whatever reason, how much longer are these fields playable for, and at what point do we just say, hey, we can't use the fields until the decision is made and things are replaced? Because if this has already been discussed for a year and a half, it's got, I think, a 10-year life cycle, we're at like 12, at which point does it just become a safety hazard to even have kids playing on these fields? In which case, what are the alternatives in terms of moving practices and games to other locations and potential costs for that? I don't know if that's been addressed, thought of?
They haven't gone to a plan B yet, but to my comment earlier about the GMAT testing, that's the impact of concussion-related testing. I strongly recommend that if this doesn't happen within the next couple of months, and if by June the ASTM standards do change their GMAT level, that the district should get another round of GMAT testing, because like, depending on what the new number is going to be, let's say it's 150, both tests were above 150 a year and a half ago, so that's the true safety, immediate safety issue, so I would try to get that.
Hopefully this year we will have a very clear and definitive proposition that we're voting on, and all of this will be for naught, but my question is, I was told last year that after the proposition was failed, that it could be brought up again in a referendum. We didn't have to wait an entire year until the next Board of Ed vote, so ostensibly, if something was chosen the community disagreed with and we voted it down again, would the Board of Ed be motivated to put out another referendum and get this fixed? Because we are approaching dangerous levels on our field right now because we're so indecisive about this. So I would like to know, although I know we have a policy against answering questions, if we're concerned enough to put this out in a referendum again, should it fail, are we determined to get this done this year correctly? With community support and Board of Ed support and teacher support and parent support and everyone's support.
Wondering if you have any data that if a coconut infill is safe for children with a coconut allergy.
My understanding it is, but I will take that back to our R&D guys and back to the geofill folks and find out.
Yeah, I think data and just to make
an
informed, that it would be safe for all children.
Yeah, I would hope. I mean, this stuff's been around for I think 2005 and about 1,000 installs, so I think there's probably a good body of installs out there that they can work off, but I'll bring that back.
Just thought of another question directed towards Shaw. You mentioned that you've done the field at NIAC in Pleasantville. I assume you've done many other fields over the last several years. Have you seen a shift in what schools are choosing in the last several years away from Crum? Are schools making a deliberate choice to avoid the Crum and go more towards an EPDM, towards a coconut, towards a cork, to something a little less controversial, shall we say?
Yeah, I mean, it's not a huge shift. It's pockets. It's California, for example, and in this area, Westchester, I think Pleasantville, by their move, has kind of spurred interest. I think it's, we saw a marked interest, increase in interest. NIAC went the way they did. I think Irvington is going to be bidding next week, and that's going to be that spec with a coconut infill, not specifically ours, but there's the two suppliers listed in there. So Jersey, where I live, is for a while nothing happened. Now we see a few schools here recently are at least entertaining alternates. Connecticut has been another one that's investigated. But sometimes we see people really look down the road and then they look at the facts and they look at the cost and that not necessarily should be based on that, but and they decide to go back with Crum rubber. I would say the higher percentage of fields going in are still Crum rubber. I don't know the exact, it's got to be 80% or more, but it's not a huge shift, but there's a lot of talk, but it's in more pockets that I see. Of the country.
I'd like to add to that, Mr. Johnson, your concern. I did put out a survey to the athletic directors in Section 1. If you don't know, Section 1 is Rockland, Westchester, Dutchess, and Putnam counties. 58 athletic directors, so 58 different school districts responded. 31, which is 53.4%, currently have at least one Crum rubber field. 4 districts said they are currently in the process of installing at least one EPDM or virgin rubber field. 3 districts responded saying they're installing at least one organic coconut cork infill field. No district said they were going from a synthetic field back to a grass field, and no districts said they were going to go with the new chrome rubber field. So of the local areas, Sophia districts got back to me, and that was the answer. 4 virgin rubber, 3 coconut cork infill, and 0 chrome rubber, and 0 going back to grass.
Sorry, are they due for new fields, or is this kind of, at this moment in time, this is what they have?
At this moment in time, that's what the districts that are planning on it right now, that's what they've told me. There are other districts said they're starting the conversation, like Mrs. Brogan said, but they haven't got as far as talking about the infills or having an approved plan moving forward.
Okay, sorry, so 58 districts are planning on replacing their
fields? No, 58 districts responded to the survey. I wanted to know what they currently had, and also are they currently planning on installing a field right now, or do they have an approved plan moving forward? 7 of them said they have an approved plan moving forward, 4 of them are EPDM rubber, 3 of them were the organic infill. Okay, and all those 58 schools that responded, nobody said, we have a chrome rubber field, we're going back to grass. And nobody said that they were going to have a new chrome rubber field.
Good evening. I'd like to thank the panel as well. Play a little devil's advocate here. If they're salespeople, why wouldn't they try to sell us the most expensive thing?
What's the profit margin for you guys on one rubber versus two? Does it make a higher profit on one versus the other?
I think it correlates pretty. I mean, it's more those materials are more expensive, so I think it just tracks.
Right, it's built into the cost, correct?
So your way, it's the same difference.
I would say you pay, I actually had those numbers up there, just to give you an example. Chrome rubber costs us 15 cents a pound, sand is 7 cents a pound, just to give you a magnitude. On the other hand, we pay 75 cents a pound for the geofill, so it really relates in the higher cost. And for us, there's no difference. Envirofill is like 25 cents a pound, but because it's so small and heavy, you use more of it, but yeah, there's no real difference that, in profit margin for us. And I think that's across the board for any of the turf manufacturers.
And so that was just my first point. I deal with a lot of sales reps in my line of business. So if they were coming here trying to at least sell us the most expensive product. Second, I know we mentioned a plan B, just in case the fields weren't ready, so on and so forth. The most logical plan B would probably be Torn Valley. Which I believe has
chrome rubber.
I mean, just to comment on a plan B, I mean, from my side, and Tim sort of mentioned it, what I'd recommend if you got to that point is, before the season starts, the most important thing you can do is do that ASTM 355, the GMAX test again, but before that, I would get an independent. It doesn't have to be independent, but a maintenance person that has deep grooming equipment, and there's guys out there, and give those fields a deep grooming. Get an analysis. Possibly you could extract some of the infill, because when that field went in, it was probably a percentage of 60-70% sand and 30% rubber. That was the mix in those days. So there's a possibility you could extract some of that and add rubber in there to increase the shock absorbency. But there is a process you could go through, provided this fiber structure would hold it. And I assume it would for at least the season. But deep grooming, analyze the infill to see if it can be improved on for shock absorbency. And then before the kids, go back on there in the fall, do the ASTM 355 like you've been doing, and just get a current test that you have, to support the activity that you're doing out there.
Just a couple of comments on the plan B. Torn Valley is not a plan B option for you. And for simple reason is the capacity that is used there is equal or greater than what you're seeing on the fields here. So to think you could lift and load all of the capacity that would be needed from here and move to Torn Valley, just not a reality. You would still be faced with shutting down youth programs in order to, if that was the plan B decided upon, you would still have to shut down significant amount of the program, which would be a disaster. Just a couple of comments I want to bring up. One, I didn't feel the presentation was skewed towards chrome rubber. I thought it was very complete in that it covered the other infills as well, because I think sometimes in our minds it's skewed. I'm not picking on Dan. But I think it was complete in that it represented the other materials. I think for me personally, I run a youth sports organization here. First and foremost is going to be the safety of what goes in. I don't want that to be misconstrued as putting grass. I think the best option for us is a synthetic solution. And I think as the board evaluates all the different options that are there, whether it be from the infill perspective, the pad perspective, the length of fiber, I wouldn't gear it towards any particular sport other than to say it should be geared towards perhaps the safest denominator. So if football demands the highest safety, then gear the surface sports football. Soccer ball goes a little slower. A five-year-old is not going to worry about it. The other part about this, and I know it's been a long process, but the part that's most concerning for me right now is the timeline, and Dan started on it. Is there time to get it in between now and the start of the fall season? And what I was kind of hearing as we were talking about it is it's tight. And am I correct in that assessment, or am I misreading the timeline?
Yeah, if you needed it, when is the training start? Mid-August? Yeah, so if you backed up, say, 6 weeks from there, you know, July 1 start, it'd be tight, but it would be the time frame that most of these go in. But they're all tight in the summer. If you made a decision June 1st, I'm going to tell you would be ahead of, like I say, a quarter, but you would be ahead of a lot of folks that still want to do fields for the fall season. It's just the nature of our business right now. So things would have to hit right for you on your vote and all this stuff. But yeah, I mean, you're still, you know, a July 1 start would get you there for the season.
So in short, it's doable.
Oh yeah, yeah, no question.
Thank you.
I have one last thing too. I want to thank you very much for coming out here and helping explain all our different options. And I would strongly encourage the board to be very specific when they write the resolution for it to come up for vote, because I want to vote for new turfs, but I will not vote it unless there are specific language in there eliminating some of the options that many of us do not agree on. And I would also encourage our community members to come out the next two board meetings to voice their concerns and voice their supports, because if we don't speak up, then we're to blame for what happens. So if everyone can please come out, come to the meetings, and vote their conscience when the vote comes up. And thank you again for answering all of our questions. I guess I have a question for the community. What other types of information does the community feel that they need in order to feel informed? So I guess some guidance for the board about what else we should do.
Don't just give us a 5-hour notice. I just got an email today that is about tonight's meeting.
I'm a kindergarten parent who has this combo around my kids. And I could take a Ziploc bag over the past 3 years of what I've taken out of their underwear.
Just saying, I don't have weird kids. They don't stuff it in their underwear, but it gets in there. My daughter, I can literally fill a Ziploc bag. The stuff's in her underwear. I picked it out of their ears, in their scalp. So whatever I see on a ballot, I want to be able to look up from a medical perspective. What happens if this is in my daughter's underwear? Like, what is this doing to her? I understand his athletes, I have huge respect for her, but I had a 4-year-old in kindergarten and I was picking this out of her underwear. So I don't think that's being addressed as much as the athletes. I understand that's important, but we also have to remember we have Montebello Elementary School students that start at 4 years old in our school,
and this stuff's in their hair and their ear every other day they go to gym. When they play on, they do sit-ups, they roll around, I don't know what they do, but they come home with it, it's everywhere. So whatever you're putting in, it's not just impact, it's literally going into little children's bodies. So I would really like some information on that. So I want to be able to look up, okay, it's coconuts, what does that do? So that's just
so
something.
A health expert that can answer some of those questions.
About small children. We talk about athletes and soccer and this, but I don't know where all the Montebello parents are, but we all have the same problem. And we all want to know about small children's bodies and whatever the infill is that affects them. Because gym is every other day, and we're happy they go outside. And we know that's a lot of times that's where they go. Thank you.
I would just like a clarification from the board. Last year, all we wanted was for the wording to be clear that it would be non-chrome rubber and we would have passed the referendum. And we were told that we were beyond the 45-day deadline. So I'd like to know why this year at the last board meeting, when I asked for clarification on that, we were told it was April 2nd, which your next board meeting is until April 5th, why all of a sudden we now can do it within 30 days when last year, when we could have saved a whole year of these kids being and staff and everyone else being exposed to these fields, why were we told last year that legally we could not do that? I'd like an answer from the board on that.
I think in response to Dr. Howard's question, we're still confused because you're still confused. Mr. Long is turning around and telling the rest of you, we've all decided we're just going to go with organics, right? And we see some nodding and some head shaking. What is going on? We don't know what you guys are thinking. So we don't know what questions to start asking. If I had known chrome rubber is off the table, I wouldn't have spent all of my time looking at chrome rubber research. I just want to know what you guys are thinking. Give us some guidance. Give us some leadership. Narrow it down for us to what you're thinking on. That's what we voted for you for. That's why we put you there. We have to ratify this decision. It is our decision ultimately to make, the communities and the parents of this community. But we rely on your expertise, and there seems to be so much dissent and so many discussions on the side between you guys. No one seems to be on the same page, and we can't just get a clear answer. Is organic infill the only option that we are considering, as Mr. Long stated, and you all apparently have at one point or another said, or is that not the case? Why is it so difficult to get an answer to that question, or for that matter, pretty much any question from the Board of Ed?
Is too tight and too close to the fact that maybe our numbers will not actually be approved by standards that might change on us. So I commend you for starting the work and the research early. Second of all, when asked about the duration of time it could take us, our engineering consultants looked at Mr. Shaw as if it's the one, you know, company that we're going to use. I sure hope that we have the ability to look at many other providers in order to save our district much needed money. Yes, we do have a capital fund to use, but it doesn't mean that we want to be wasteful. We want to use the safest possible option, and I urge you as a board member and a parent and a citizen of this community to use the safest option, but also to save us as much money as possible. Because money, as we know, is becoming very difficult to come by. I have done my personal research and looked into providers of the coconut husk mixed with cork, which is the natural infill, and found that it would be cheaper for our district to obtain that from directly from a supplier of the infill as opposed from the turf companies. And it would not negate the process of being on the state list. We would still be able to go with a provider of turf on the state list without the bid process. So please look into cutting the middleman and saving the district money using an infill, natural infill company. Finally, I also am concerned about using, from a toxicology perspective, the principle of it's safe until proven unsafe is not how scientists normally address medical concerns. We adhere to the principle of using the precautionary principle. And you would agree with me, the precautionary principle, to make sure that if something is even suspected to be hazardous, not be used and not expose children in particular to, because it's not, you know, a lawsuit situation yet, and it's not a court of law where you're, you know, innocent until proven guilty. It's the precautionary principle, and that's what we as scientists use.
Okay, I just want to thank the panelists again. It was extremely informative, at least I know it was for us, and I'm sure it was for the public who was able to stay through the entire presentation. Hopefully we answered most of your questions. If there's any other questions, feel free to email Andy. His email is on the website. And I want to thank everybody again for coming out. Motion to adjourn Teresa, second.